Welcome to the Resilience Conversations, a portal into the world of inspiration and creative thinking about finding our inner strength and learning how to use it. I'm Rondi Charleston, and I'm so excited to share some practical, helpful, and in some cases, mind-boggling insight from some of today's most highly respected thinkers, leaders, and artists. I hope you'll join me in this fascinating series about learning and cultivating the essential qualities of resilience. Welcome to the Resilience Conversations. I am Rondi Charleston, and I'm sitting down today with world-renowned superstar physicist Brian Greene in his office at Columbia University. And thank you so much, Brian, for taking the time out of your very, very busy schedule to sit down and just chat with us a little bit.
My pleasure.
Full disclosure, I am a huge fan, as you know. I've read all of your books. As a layperson and a musician, I am captivated by the way that you explain science. And I don't always understand it, but I find it fascinating the way that you approach it. And I want to talk to you today about a bunch of things, but the concept of resilience is kind of foremost in my mind. It's something that everybody seems to be needing to talk about these days. It's we need to cultivate it in ourselves and grow it in order basically to survive in this out-of-control world. So let me start just by asking you, how can science help us become more resilient?
I find that if people, and by people I really mean mean, I'm assuming that it's true for most, when you can see where your life fits into the larger landscape of reality, it gives a very different way of thinking about the hurdles, the problems, the opportunities that the world presents to you. And I really do find that I constantly try to live in the real world like everybody else does, but I try to pull out from that and see the Earth in orbit around the sun and see the sun in the corner of this galaxy and see this galaxy, which is one of 100 billion other galaxies in a universe that's expanding. It's been around for 14 billion years. And when you look at it that way, things that happen over the course of a couple years, a lifetime, it somehow is placed in a different light. And I think that can give a certain kind of resilience when you recognize that reality is so much bigger than any one life.
You talked about this in an NPR piece that I read that was really interesting. How can science help us transcend religious and political divisions?
Well, you know, I received a letter from an American soldier who was in Iraq. And he wrote to me from there, from Greater Baghdad. And he said, when I get into the physics of quantum mechanics, and when I get into the ideas of an expanding universe and relativity, the divisions between us and them, the divisions between this faith and that faith, it, for a brief moment, doesn't matter. It all drifts, it all evaporates. And I think that's the real opportunity of science, to prevent us from focusing upon the differences by virtue of recognizing that we're all part of the same reality governed by the same laws. And when you look at it that way, these minor differences, they just kind of all go away. You know, I mean, Carl Sagan said it really well. You look at planet Earth from way out in space, right? The pale blue dot version of planet Earth, looking at Earth that we can now do, you know, from the Cassini probe, looking back at Earth from Saturn. And on a big screen, Earth is less than one pixel. And within that single little pixel, we're all fighting for a little piece of sky. And if you can take a look back and say, goodness gracious, the whole Earth is less than a little pixel. What are we doing? How insane is it? That's the perspective that I think can really make all of the fine details just not matter as much.
Yeah, is that kind of like the saying, you know, we are but a speck of dust in a minor galaxy in the junkyard of the universe?
Yeah, it sounds like Animal House, right?
Right.
Right? When they're all like looking at their thumb and looking at all the particles in there, wondering that we may be the thumb in some gigantic being. So yes, one can take this in various directions, but the nice thing, the thing that goes beyond that rough summary of the situation, is that there's so much unity in science. Einstein himself was looking for the unified theory of all the forces of nature, and he didn't find it, but we think we're hot on the trail of the unified theory, which would be one equation that might describe all matter, all forces, in one mathematical sentence. How beautiful for that unity. And then you go beyond physics and you look at chemistry, you look at life. All life that we know about descended from a common ancestor, and we see that in the biological record. All of our cells generate and process energy in exactly the same way. All of our cells store information in exactly the same way. Even though there's this wealth of life on planet Earth, when you get down to rock bottom details, we're operating according to the same rules, according to the same mechanisms. And when you see that deep unity, you appreciate the wealth of distinct life forms and perspectives, but you recognize that it really does all come from the same place. And I just can't help but thinking that if more people could take that attitude, the unity of biology, the unity of physics, the unity of the universe, that things would hit us, appear to us, seem to us very different from the way they do on the surface.
Why do you think that people are so afraid of science?
Because you can be wrong in science. That's an unfortunate or fortunate quality of the subject, depending on your perspective. In many other fields, it's kind of a matter of opinion.
Talk for a minute about the wonder of discovery and the emotional process of going from confusion to understanding, and why is that beneficial? Why is that important?
I think that's one of the profound moments in a thinking person's experience. You know, I've worked with kids who have had trouble with math or science, and I've tried to teach them a small piece of physics or mathematics. And you can always find a sufficiently small step that even somebody who's having difficulty can triumph. And to watch somebody undergo that triumph, to not understand something and then get it, however small the step is, that's a transformative move in someone's psychological makeup. And it's an experience that everybody needs to have at the youngest possible age, because it is empowering. It shows you that you yourself can take that step. And that's where intellectual independence really comes from.
And resilience as well.
It's a huge moment for emboldening one's resilience, because there you have it. You're faced with the problem, and internally you find the fortitude and the capacity to put the pieces together and take even a tiny step forward. I mean, regardless of how small the step is, that's the key thing. It may be difficult, but as long as you take that step.
Right, even if it's a baby step. That's,
even if it's a baby step, you're moving in a direction that's yours, and that's the moment that matters.
Do you think, let's talk about curiosity for a minute, and it seems to me that as a country we had a lot of curiosity in our DNA back in the days of Benjamin Franklin, and it seems like our curiosity is dwindling, shriveling as a country. Any thoughts on that?
Well, I don't actually think that our curiosity is dwindling. I think that if you look around at what the culture values, that there's a segment of the culture that's placing less value on innovation and creativity than we might hope. But we begin life as creative explorers. That is who we are from the get-go. And, you know, why do kids smash things together and pull it apart? Because they are explorers. And like all parents, you know, I at some point stopped my kids from destroying things. I wish I hadn't. It's hard not to, right? Because we all have the two sides to our perspective on the world. But that's where kids start. And where we fail is that we don't allow that to flower, to flourish in the way that it could. And not everybody agrees with me by any means, but part of that I feel strongly is we are so assessment oriented. In school, we try to teach in a way that we can test in order that we can have data describing progress. And the problem with that is the act of being assessed runs counter to the creative spirit. So the goal, I would think, is to have an educational system where we're actually allowing the creativity to really flourish. My hope is that as we move to the realm, not of personalized medicine, which is what gets a lot of attention, but personalized education, where we really can set up novel, innovative digital systems that can be catered to one student or another, they will allow, if they're good, and in the future they will be able to take a student and find their sweet spot, find the trajectory that really aligns with how their brain is constructed, allowing them to go forward and reach their potential without having some overarching standardized exam that everybody's got to take and everybody therefore teaches to that exam. That to me is the real thing that tamps down our creativity and our spirit of innovation.
Brilliant. Changing gears a little bit, you are passionate about music and your father was a musician. Tell me some of the parallels between music and science.
The universe gives you information, whether it's observations of the stars or from a Large Hadron Collider or from gravitational waves, whatever. You've got patterns, and it's up to you to find the mathematics that describes those patterns. And as a composer, I'd watch my dad, and he was constantly trying to take patterns from the world and incorporate them in a way that would make sonic sense, that would make sense from a musical perspective. So I always sort of viewed it as the world is full of patterns, and he took them in one way and transformed them into music, and I and scientists take it in a different way and try to transform it into equations.
Talk a little bit about the musicals that you're working on for the World Science.
Yeah, so in essence, in my recent years, I've been kind of putting these two together. We have recognized that hearing a lecture on science or hearing a discussion of science can be very powerful, but ultimately it just reaches you cognitively, right? And we're talking about these ideas. For the most part, your head is trying to grasp some of the scientific concepts if we were to go into them. But how much more powerful would it be if when those concepts are coming at you, you're not just thinking about them, you're kind of feeling them. And music and theater is a potent device for reaching right beneath the cognitive surface and touching us in a visceral way. So we've created some theatrical works that explore general relativity or explore quantum mechanics, but in a manner where a drama is being played out on stage, typically a historical one. The historical discovery of these ideas is utterly spectacular, but combining a historical outlay of these ideas together with music, we work a lot with Jeff Beal and Philip Glass, that can really reach in and grab you. Now your experience of the scientific ideas is that much more rich.
Wonderful. In closing, you've said that the breathtaking ideas of science can nourish not only the mind, but also the soul.
Can you elaborate
on that a little bit?
Well, it's really more along the lines of what we've been discussing. As a scientist, when I encounter a great result, whether it's my own or somebody else's, I can find it breathtaking, not just interesting, not just something which gives me sort of a cognitive moment of joy, but it can really make me feel how wondrous it is to be part of this universe. And the goal of the work that I'm doing, I work with the World Science Festival and through the various ways that we try to reach the public is that the person who's not going to go to graduate school in science can still have that experience. They can still have that experience of taking in a scientific insight and finding that their heart is pounding and finding that you know their spine is tingling because they feel like they're seeing a deep truth of reality. And it's those moments that make it all worthwhile.
And I thank you because you've given me several of those moments as I've been reading and watching your PBS specials of spine tingling, just absolute thrilling excitement with this whole world of possibility. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.